I'm delighted that so many of you are able to join us today. With me are two other sort of experts in this area. I am the chair of ALT, but I'm joined by some real experts in this particular topic area of John Traxler and Agnes Chigona. So I'm delighted that they're able to lead this session for us today. What we have is a number of really good speakers as well who are joining us, and there are going to be plenty of opportunities for discussion as we proceed through this hour. But first, I just want to highlight a couple of housekeeping pointers. And those are that we have a chat function available for us today in Collaborate. Hopefully many of you have used this solution before, but if you haven't, just click at the bottom of the screen. There's a little sort of purple chevron icon. And then within there, you can then see a chat button that you can then click and see the chat. So please use that for any questions or any comments that you have through the session. And we'll pick up those when we have our chat and our panel discussion. Also, there will be some polling activities towards the end of the presentation. So please look out for those links, and we'd love for you to join in on those. We'll be recording this session, as Maren said, and hopefully try to share that with you within a day or so. And also, I've just included here just a polite message that if you do have video, maybe it's best to disable that, because we have people joining from all over the world and just want to save bandwidth and not sort of have any impairments to the experience today. And also just a mention of the hashtag of this session today. It is hashtag ALTWM underscore decolonise. So please feel free to use that to post your comments, your experiences of today, and anything else you want to share with the rest of the world. Okay, so I just want to hand over now to Agnes, and Agnes is going to introduce the sessions that we have today. Agnes.
Thank you, John. Hi all. Thank you for joining this webinar. My name is Agnes Chigona. I'm a professor in the Faculty of Education at the Cape Peninsula University of Technology in Cape Town in South Africa. And my research interests are in ICTs in education. I am very much passionate in digital pedagogies in teacher education. So I'll be chairing this session today. And as you know, the session is about decolonizing learning technology. Yes. So I was looking at, the meaning of decolonization, and the Oxford Learner's Dictionary defines decolonization as the process of a colony or colonies becoming independent. So in the session, I am interested in getting answers to questions about the extent to which our digital pedagogies, technologies we use for teaching and learning, are perpetuating colonization or assisting with decolonization in education. So I think I shouldn't take much of the time, but we are privileged to have experts presenting their research within the field, helping us understand what decolonizing learning technology is and how we can go about it. And yeah, our first presenter is Professor John Traxler from the University of Wolverhampton. He is presenting about decolonizing technology. So Professor Traxler, you have 7 minutes for the presentation, and that will be followed by questions for 3 minutes. So over to you, John.
Okay, thank you. And John, you're driving the slides?
Yeah, that's correct. So you should see this, the first slide on the screen now, John. Just say whenever you want me to change the slide for you.
Well, no, sadly not. I'll have to guess. I don't know okay. why, but probably better to press on. I mean, yeah, and I ought to say, well, thanks for that introduction. I think Agnes poses the right question, or at least half of the right question, because I think decolonisation certainly has many different aspects and appears in several different guises. And so there is an experience of colonisation in the ex-colonies of the European colonising powers, of which obviously South Africa is one, but there are plenty more, and of which other members of the European community have also got their legacy. And that's one half of the picture, or maybe only one third. Another portion, another third of that picture is the extent to which migrant communities from the ex-colonies of those empires now live as migrants in the host communities of the ex-colonial powers. So we have all manner of communities in the UK, but there are similar parallel communities in France and probably, I guess, Spain and a variety of other countries as well, all of which experience colonization, colonization of educational technology and e-learning in their different ways. And as someone pointed out to me recently, the de-Russification of, for example, Kazakhstan and Kyrgyzstan, or perhaps the Baltic states, Latvia, for example, might also have a parallel agenda in that they're attempting to reassert or develop some national identity, and clearly education and the technologies that deliver it must be a part of that. So yeah, thank you for the introduction, Agnes. I was hoping to keep my remarks as short as possible, and to that end had posted a couple of blogs on the ALT website, which maybe say nothing new. They reflect thinking of a year or two, 3 years ago, an attempt to pull them together. And one of those bits of thinking relates to the technology itself and the extent to which it is permeated by colonial thinking, values, concepts, and so on. And I'll come back to that in the course of the slides. We are also running two more webinars where we hope to do justice to more of the contributions and more of the ideas that come up. And in some senses, we're I am certainly apologizing for us being taken by surprise with this webinar and the extent to which there's been so much interest in it, and we're running to catch up. So hopefully we'll do some of that catching up in the subsequent webinars. Okay, John, next slide, the one entitled definitions, please. I hope this isn't kind of a sterile academic exercise looking for a definition. But nevertheless, it does point out some aspects of it. I mean, the first one is actually from an African newspaper and sees it in African terms. I mean, in the way perhaps Agnes was portraying it. The other one comes from the University of Kiel. Rather ironically, or perhaps rather sadly, I notice they've used the American spelling, which kind of tells us something. And as I was saying, there are a variety of definitions, depending on whether one's coming at it, as it were, from a domestic point of view or an overseas point of view. And also, I suppose, the extent to which it's on the one hand an issue of, I don't know, and historical injustice, I mean, in our relationships to other people in other countries and their experience of learning technology, but also, if you like, a current threat when we look at the global dominance of digital corporations and where they come from and the values that are embedded in them. So really, I'm just drawing attention to the many different facets of this issue. And I suppose needing to place us in some respects within a wider context of decolonization. To a broader extent, I suppose you can align it with Black Lives Matter and Roads Must Fall in different countries in different ways. But also actually the appropriation of indigenous knowledge, the attempts to preserve or appropriate cultural heritage, and also recent attempts, you know, within the last few days to discuss the repatriation of Benin bronzes to Nigeria, or to repatriate the, sorry, and I have to say Elgin marbles, which is clearly the wrong name because they're the Parthenon friezes, back to Greece. So yes, it's part of that wider context within the sphere of education. We're seeing quite a lot of work around decolonizing the curriculum and decolonizing research, and the work of decolonizing the curriculum can sometimes be presented as opening up opportunities to those communities that are underrepresented or disempowered. But I think actually, whilst that might be true, it's also worth thinking about the extent to which decolonizing the curriculum represents a much, much richer, wider curriculum for everyone involved in the education system, and not just for minority and migrant communities. So that's a kind of attempt to provide some sort of definition. If we move on to the next slide, John. It just points out that certainly from my personal history, I realise I must have been thinking about this issue over the last maybe decade, and have made several different attempts to think about it. And this represents three of those attempts: the technology itself of learning technology, the theorising of it, and the digital literacy which underpins it. So if we move on to the slide that says some questions. These were just the kind of things I think we ought to be asking ourselves in relation to, well, our students' experience, but also our lecturers and staff and researchers' experience of the day-to-day use of learning technology, and asking ourselves what white European influences do we spot when we're using those technologies. And I suppose white European might be a term we can extend to white settler influences if we're looking at the scope and prestige of the USA. And maybe there's also a phrase that would embrace other colonializing powers and their influences, Arabic ones across North Africa, for example. And below that, I just enumerated some more specific questions in the hope they'd provoke you to spotting it in your work, really. You know, the issue of icons, gestures, emojis on your phones, on your tablets, on your laptops, on your desktops, and certainly in the blog I'd identified some of those, but even so I keep spotting more. And I think back with a certain amount of embarrassment 20 years ago running a European project that included Italy, and we thought with English developers all we needed to do was scrape off the teacups and the red buses and put on some coffee cups and some green bendy buses, but you can start at that level scraping away, I don't know, white paper bins and files and egg timers and clocks, and then you find another layer and another layer and another layer.
Sorry, John, you've got just 30 seconds to go.
Oh dear, sorry, that's really hard, isn't it? Okay. Yeah, so you can work through those questions, and hopefully everyone will contribute their own examples. And there's one more question on the following slide, just to draw your attention to the various people who might be affected or afflicted by these experiences. So not just African communities, but also, as I say, Berber or Cree or Urdu or Kikuyu people. Okay, two more slides, one more. Next one, John, the one about digital literacy.
So we've got one about learning theory here, John. What do you want the next slide?
Oh, okay, sorry, the question there is actually just spot the theorist who isn't a white European. and the last one about digital literacy, is slightly random because I'm sure there's a whole bunch of issues in, but it is the foundation of our digital learning. But I worry about the extent to which the way the world is thinking about it is modelled upon European expectations, experiences, values, and technology and pedagogy as well. And so, you know, I think we need to be very, very cautious about other countries importing what we have done that has built on a European context that is completely irrelevant in other countries. It is, as I say, the foundation of digital learning, and we have to be careful that we're not building other people's digital learning on our conceptions in Europe of digital literacy. Okay, I hope I kept to time. Thank you very much for the opportunity for that high speed.
Thank you so much. Thank you, John, for the presentation. Yes, and now we have questions for you. The first question I see here, thinking of the practices that technology enables, inclusive, exclusive, cultural, etc., what we do with the technology and the structures it supports perpetuates? So, John? Are you there?
Sorry, I was muted. I'm sorry. Can you repeat that, please?
I think the question is about what these technologies are perpetuating. I also had that similar question that, you know, if I take our example, South Africa, most of the technologies we use for teaching and learning are coming from the Western countries. And now, how can we decolonize that same technology and be able to compete at the global level?
Oh, okay. I mean, I guess I only have half the answer to that, partly because I think we're all still only thinking it through. And once we thought it through, then perhaps we'll have some strategies for addressing it. But I think in the first instance, the problem is awareness, that actually we don't notice it's happening, that we assume that what Microsoft or Apple do is somehow some neutral global norm. And actually to draw people's attention to the fact that it isn't, that it comes laden with all sorts of aspects of a specific and powerful culture. And that we need to look more carefully at the technologies and the learning that comes with it in order to at least be critically aware that this is what's happening to us.
Mm-hmm. Okay. John, can you read some of the questions?
Yeah, there's an interesting one here. Can I just ask one final one? Just so, John, how much of the baiting colonial designs in technology can be overcome by pedagogy? And it says, of course, pedagogy is influenced by the technology as well.
Yeah, I think that's an important issue in the sense. Well, I think there's a kind of spectrum or a sequence or a continuum that starts with the people that build and design the hardware, the software, the systems, the peripherals and so on, and builds in some of their values at the very, very outset. You know, the fact that we have a QWERTY keyboard, you know, for example, and that seems to be taken as the norm. And then you move on to the educational systems and their deployment, you know, VLEs, LMSs, and then the ways in which they are deployed within institutions. And the way that reinforces a particular, well, educational model, educational theory, and institutional commercial models as well. And then it gets passed on to the curriculum designers, the curriculum developers. And I think we shouldn't be too ambitious in thinking we can solve the whole of the problem, and ask ourselves instead, what exactly are we doing? And I guess that is around the actual digital learning pedagogy and actually the educational awareness of this issue. You know, so on the one hand, can we, through our teaching, alert people to this problem? And on the other hand, can we design, I don't know, materials, interactions that begin to address it, that set examples and also create communities and foster discussion?
Thank you so much, John, for the presentation and the response to the questions. And I see there are still many questions, but in the interest of time, we need to move on. And now we have the lightning talks, and this will be presented by Dr. Mona Yunis, Dr. Sonia Stradon, and Dr. Tuskin Adams. Over to you, ladies. And okay, so everybody has got 2 minutes to present. Then we'll have questions following your presentations, after all of you have presented. Thank you.
Yes, hi, hello, good morning, good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me properly? Greetings from California, USA. John, thank you for the slides. What I'm going to do today is it's just a trial to come up with some sort of a framework so that we can get the ball rolling while we are discussing the decolonizing learning technology. It's such a big and huge field or area where we have really to think deeply. So therefore, what do we need? We need some kind of a framework. Next, John. Okay, now where does this framework that I'm proposing coming from? A couple of years ago, and that was pre-COVID time, I was engaged with ECCN, with the USAID, and INE, the Interagency Network for Education Emergencies, because my specialty is actually working with refugees and educating them, especially in the MENA region. I was engaged in a reference group where we were sitting down and thinking about how is it possible that we implement ICT-based interventions in a conflict-sensitive manner. And in order to think about that and to come up with a checklist that is useful for implementers, we needed to have some kind of a framework. But we sat down for maybe a year or a year and a half thinking about, okay, this checklist, how are we going to frame it, what should be included, and so on. We realized that there are actually two perspectives or two layers. The first layer is actually the life cycle of a project or of an intervention. Especially, we are talking here about learning technology and its implementation in emergency and crisis settings. We realized that we need to look into the whole cycle. We need to look at the analysis cycle or the analysis phase, implementation, management, monitoring, evaluation, and even the closeout. Now, the second thing we thought about is, okay, each of those phases is very complex and there are so many aspects to it. So therefore, let's sit down and try to think deeply what are the different aspects that we have to think about. When we think about decolonizing learning technologies, we need also to think broadly, because colonization and the colonizing philosophy has actually impacted all the different aspects of the whole learning process. And I'm talking here about digital pedagogy, I'm talking about the technologies, about the communication, about different aspects. Next slide, John. Okay, at the very end, we came up with four concepts or four aspects that we see and really believe are the main ones where we need to think deeply about. And I do think the same framework could be also used when we tackle issues of decolonization. Community context, very important. Content and pedagogy, definitely very much decolonized. And communication devices and connection. Next, John. Now, when we are talking about community context, there are very important questions. One of them, are we really ensuring not to exacerbate social injustices, inequities, or oppression? Are we really doing that? Because sometimes we really do not do. And there are so many samples and examples around us that tell us, no, the way we do it is in a very decolonized way. John, the next, please. Then we have content and pedagogy. We have also other examples around the world. And if I had time, I would have told you stories and stories about how decolonized we are, how actually in a colonial manner, top-down manner, we can see curriculum being designed and given to the refugees around the world or the internally displaced people. The next. And very important question, are we widening the digital divide? Are we helping through learning technologies and the implementation of learning technologies, widening the digital divide? And I can tell you a very recent research that I was engaged in northern Syria and conflict areas, we could see that only 25% of kids had access to one smartphone during COVID and were able to continue their education. What happened to the rest 75? They were pushed down into more poverty, and child labor actually between brackets flourished very much. Why? Because learning technology was used in that context, and the kids had to be out of the whole system. Yes, the next. Very quickly. Yes. Very quickly, connections. We need to think about what are we doing? Are we exacerbating actually the power and the power and the strengths and the colonial situation position of the global corporates? Are we doing that? Is providing the connection one mean of exacerbating again inequality and enforce different kind of oppressions? There are so many different stories that I can tell where the increasing of tariffs and the use of learning technology has actually led to more oppression and more social justice and digital divide. Would there be seconds to show the video? Do we have 3 seconds?
I don't think we do actually, because we'll have to change the share. So can we actually just put that in the link to this, yes, to the in the chat, and we'll pick that up in a second.
I'm inviting you to look at that video. That video was taken in Cox Bazar in one of the refugee camps, Rohingya refugee camps, and it is showing how is digital pedagogy being implemented in that camp? How the banking model is being followed in a very, harmful way among the refugees. And I am the one who took the video, and I witnessed this horrible teaching practice happening.
Yeah, we'll put that into the chat, Mona.
Okay. Yes, please. I'm inviting everyone to have a look at this 17-second video, and you will know what I'm talking about. Thank you. That was quick.
Thank you. Yes, now can we have the next one? Sonia?
Thank you, Agnes, and thank you, colleagues, also for the opportunity. Just from my side, just quickly again, I'm from Stellenbosch University in South Africa. And maybe the purpose of my very short talk is just maybe to share with you our thoughts and the processes that we propose within our institution, also broader, in terms of starting to interrogate what we all know is critical digital pedagogies. And maybe latching onto Mona's framework that she used, and which I think is really very powerful and useful, is our emphasis is probably then on the pedagogical side, the teaching methodologies that we employ with digital technologies, and maybe the secondary side, of course, also the community context, and of course the role of students, how they play that role within our engagement with digital technology. So in terms of the why, you'll see that I have two bullet points there. I think all of us are very familiar with the fact that with the emergency remote teaching and learning and assessment period that we all experienced the past 2 years, that we also experienced that the digital came to the fore much more. It's like an ocean of waves, and we experienced that in our own institution, but also in our country as well, and talking to colleagues as well. But what we found was we actually, when we spoke to our colleagues in our division for teaching and learning enhancement, we actually worked collaboratively on an OER. We reflected on experiences of ALTWM. And one of the things that came out was that need to connect with students via the digital. So that humanizing pedagogy side came through very strongly. So that's one of our motivations for our interest. And you can have a look at that in the link that I shared with you. But broadly in the South African context, also colleagues, 13 public universities out of the 25 in South Africa participated in a joint paper that we wrote in the second bullet point that specifically spoke about equity and inequality issues in the COVID-19 period, and then also then the issues of care and how we need to embrace that as well. So those are two of the main factors that influence our thinking processes in a sense as well. The second slide, please, John. And then very briefly, the way in which we try or thinking of approaching it is the how, and we're looking at a differential approach. We're learning as we go along. Of course, in our own work, the issues of EDI in increasingly automated classrooms are questions that we're asking the whole time. And we're thinking about that third space where you bridge the gap between our issues of equity, diversity, and inclusivity, but then also issues of artificial intelligence, machine learning, all these things coming to the fore much more. How do we address that? Those are one of the aspects that we're thinking about. From an institutional perspective, we've started to plan what we call a critical digital pedagogies planning group, where we try to actually embrace cross-institutional awareness campaign in terms of this, and starting to engage with academics and students and academic support services how we actually can start to embed and start to think about critical digital pedagogies. And then last but not least is we've also involved in the African Digital University Network. You've got the link there. And we've got different working groups, and one of the working groups is actually starting to focus on the aspect of critical digital pedagogies. There'll be a call going out at the end or early next year, and you are very welcome to join that network and also to join that working group if you're interested in that. Thank you very much for the opportunity, colleagues.
Thank you so much, Sonia. We'll have more time next webinar. Can we have Taskin Adams?
Hi everyone, can you hear me loud and clear?
Yes, we can hear you. Thank
Great.
You.
Great, thank you so much, Agnes. So you can skip to the next slide. So I'm Taskin, I'm from South Africa. I did my PhD on MOOCs and how they can address injustices in education. On to the next slide, please, Agnes. John. Thanks. So, so my PhD looked at addressing injustices, and it arose from the period where roads must fall and fields must fall were happening on one side. And on the other side, there was this great development of global online learning platforms that were claiming to be the solution to all educational issues. So my research focused on whether MOOCs could address the needs, preferences, and aspirations of marginalized youth, but also focus not only on the material injustices, but the cultural, epistemic, and the political and geopolitical injustices they face. So you can go on to the next slide. Thanks. Basically, what I want to do today is just highlight three papers that I've written, which is sort of like a clickbait for you to read them and look at some of the issues I've talked about. The first one is on digital neocolonialism and MOOCs. And this talks about how, and a lot of my research focuses on the ideologies and the Western-centric epistemologies that are embedded in learning technology. So moving away from just access issues to seeing how things are embedded with Western logic. So that research looked at how Western-centric epistemologies are embedded into MOOCs and how this can be detrimental for when you're trying to educate diverse and complex participants from around the globe. It also looked at not only the past in terms of colonial agendas, but new techno-capitalist agendas that transcend borders. The second paper then looked at MOOC designers and their embodiment and epistemic location. The fact that many MOOC designers are based in global north institutions and how those knowledges and are forefronted in what they design. And this research highlighted that basically MOOCs represent what MOOC designers, who they are, how they think, what they value. And therefore you really need to have an epistemically diverse group of MOOC designers that can bring in different cultures and different value systems and different epistemologies into thinking about how MOOCs are designed. Just a quick example is, you know, MOOCs are designed for one user to interact through a profile, whereas there are so many community learnings of models of education. Just looking at that. On the third paper, I look at the difference between social justice and decolonization, and this came up in the chat as well. Social justice theories tend to be rooted from a Western point of view.
I mean, Tuskin.
Thank you. Yes. They tend to be rooted from global North literature, although recent social justice literature has in sort of merged with decolonial literature. However, decolonial literature rarely came from the South. And so there's different understandings in how these are. And just going on to the next slide, that literature basically builds upon this dimensions of human injustice framework that draws from the social justice theories that look at redistribution and those from material levels to more geopolitical and epistemic levels, and then draws in the decoloniality aspects that really look at forefronting different ideas and epistemologies. And this is the framework that I've used in my research to map and understand, to critically analyze learning technologies. I'll stop there. I think the one last thing I would say is what my research sought to do is to design an approach to designing justice-orientated and decolonized MOOCs. So hoping that will be an example going forward. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Tuskin, for the presentation. And thank you to our three presenters. Now we have questions for the presenters, the three presenters. John, do you have any questions on the chat?
I haven't had a chance to actually check on anything yet. I've just been so busy with the slides, but if anybody can push forward any questions that there are. I'm sorry that we've had to rush through so many of those talks. While I'm waiting for someone to come through, I will say that we're hoping to do a couple more webinars and those with lightning talks. This time, you know, can talk a little bit more fully in the next sessions, because obviously there's so much of interest in there that we'd love to be able to get more information out to you. So we've got a question here. So what's the relationship between epistemic location and designers' conceptualizations? Is there anything definite we can say about this? I'll ask that to Tuskin first.
Thanks. Thank you. So I've popped the link that will explain that in detail. But yes, that came out so strongly. So to be quite frank, when I looked at the handful of Black Global South MOOC designers, they brought such different concepts into the work that they did. And it really brought into a different understanding of, like, they were trying to challenge epistemic injustices in their work, and they brought different elements into the design of the MOOC, not just at the end, like not just a discussion at the end, but brought different speakers from around the globe. So there was a very significant difference in the design of the MOOCs and how collaborative and engaging they was based on the different MOOC designers.
Great, thank you. I've just seen a question just came up there. Let me just see if there was another one. Question from Miranda. Maybe this is to Mona. Is language one of the aspects you considered in the South African context?
South African context. When I did my PhD research, it was about the MENA region and specifically about the Syrian refugees in Jordan. But language is definitely also part of the whole issue of decolonization, because what we can see that we have, for instance, Arabic. Although we have so many Arabic speakers, I can't recall how many now the exact statistic, but we have only 5 to 4.5% of the content that is there out there online is in Arabic. For language is a very big issue. Whenever a child wants to know more about the solar system, unfortunately, he would refer mostly to curriculum, to resources that have been written in English, because there is a scarce of resources and learning material that is in Arabic. For language is a very, very big issue, a very big one. Yes.
Great. Thanks very much indeed, Mona. And I'm just conscious of time. We've got two more speakers to come, and there'll be plenty of time for questions, I hope, before the end of this hour. So perhaps let's move on now and move on to, I think Samantha was coming next, and then we've got Kate. So Samantha, I think you're going to share your screen. Is that correct?
Yes, I'm trying to.
Yes. I think I've got the order right.
Yeah, no, I'm trying to. It's just having a bit of a... Right, there we go. Okay, awesome. Okay,
so, you have got 7 minutes.
Yep, I will be brief, but understandable, hopefully. So I'm going to give a quick overview about the Anti-Racism Learn Technology Working Group, which is, I'm a part of, what it is, how we started, why should we care about this, and what we're doing. As I said, I will try to keep it brief. Okay, so how things started off. So Matt Lingard, who a lot of you may know, he attended a talk by Angela Sarney last autumn that I think had him thinking a lot along the way that a lot of us are thinking, and that we do think in this critical digital pedagogic way question technologies. So he literally put out a mass call to the community going, you know, is anybody else thinking about this, and does anybody else want to do anything about it? And that's what kind of brought us to this Anti-Racism Learn Technology Working Group. And, you know, we kind of kicked off in, I think, January of this year, actually. And we are looking to become an alt-SIG. We are a community of practice. We are people from across the spectrum of learning technology that really want to kind of address this kind of issues with the technologies and what happens with them and the things that are baked in. And, you know, and there are three subgroups for this, things that we think about. There's the content developers group, which I'm part of. I've done a lot of learning design work in the past, so that kind of makes more sense. There's things around research connected activities and just questions about the recruitment and staff development as well within learning technology. It is ridiculously white. You know, there isn't as much diversity in these teams as we would hope in some places. And, you know, and even where there is diversity, unfortunately, like a lot of higher education, it's in the lower levels. It doesn't feed all the way through. I will get that out in a way that makes sense in a minute. Okay, and so far there's been a series of blog posts. That there was one that introduced the group as a whole, and then each group has had their own posts. And John's going to share the slides, and there's links to the blog posts actually in the notes for this. And then the research group actually did a presentation at the Altwinter conference. Okay, so that's kind of the background to all of this. And I'm not going to be apologetic for putting this here, because I know that this is an incredibly powerful poem, and I picked it on purpose because we have to remind ourselves that, you know, by being bystanders, we're complicit in reproducing and maintaining inbuilt inequalities and systemic racism and other social injustices in these tools and the approaches. And I think that's kind of crucial. And for me personally, a couple of years ago, I read two books. I read Renny Edo Lodge's Why I'm No Longer Talking to White People About Race. And for me, that was quite profound. It made me see things I hadn't seen. You know, I am very much a, you can almost argue I walk around with rose-tinted glasses. I want to see the good in the world and leave the world a better place. I don't always see the underside of things, and I don't always question things that I should question. So that book made me kind of go, oh, okay, that's not cool, that's not right. And at the same time, I was reading Count Bopel's White Privilege as well, and about how we privilege things and people in our education systems. And you know, there's also that discussion about unacceptable whiteness as well. So I totally agree with Laurie's comments in the chat about, you know, it's not just a colonization thing, it is a equitable and a social justice thing, and they're not always the same thing. But we need to be mindful aware of them. You know, I'm very aware that I am first in family, first gen to go to university. I remember the first time I walked into UCL and I was like, this, what? It didn't compute. And, you know, I felt very different. But I'm also acceptable. You know, I, as they put it, code switch. And there's interesting things said by Ruha Benjamin saying that we shouldn't have to. You know, I do it subconsciously. The way I'm speaking now is very different to how I would speak at home to the friends that I grew up with, and it is completely a subconscious thing because I've learned to code switch. And you know, is that something that's truly necessary as well? You know, should you have to change to survive? And I literally mean survive in a culture. So why should we care? Well, I think we care because technology and pedagogies are not apolitical. They can't be. They're socially constructed and they construct society. They're the two things. I was actually really quite disappointed by a comment, actually, someone reported about JISC in this week's about, you know, let's forget about the ethics of AI and let's think about how to roll it out and how it might be useful. And I'm like, you can't. The two things can't be ignored. You have to truly think about both. I think that we have to share the load as well. You know, it is not one person's job to say about this, but I'm also very aware of being an ally and truly being an ally. I have no desire to be a white savior, and I'm very cautious of doing that and knowing that we have this power.
1 minute, 30 seconds.
Yeah, that's fine. You know, that we have power. And in a way, because I am the norm, there are things that I can say and I can do which won't be taken in the same way that they may be by somebody else. So it is a very careful balancing act, but it is everybody's job. And I think we need to remember that it is our job. And maybe because we're not seen as a threat, you know, we should be doing a bit more about it. So in terms of the content development group, we had kind of two questions that we address in the Review of Frameworks blog, and these were frameworks for decolonization and inclusive curricula. And thinking a bit about what that kind of meant, to the point now where, based on actually John Traxler's post in the alt group, the work that we are doing with this and in conversations with Monica, that we are in the process of drafting I don't know if a framework or a toolkit is the best way to describe it. For how as learning designers, learning technologists, we can think about this. We can think about questioning the things that are presented to us to build in online courses, about the technologies that we're asked to review, to implement, and the implications for that. I'm personally looking at learning design frameworks and where we can introduce, you know, thinking more broadly about what values are we embedding, you know, what content is there and what does that represent, and what stereotypes are we reproducing that are good and bad. So we have a session at the ALTWM conference where we are going to introduce the current version of the toolkit, and we're going to be opening up for some community feedback on that. So we are currently in the process of building it and a little supporting website. So I'm going to leave it there because there is so much to say and think and do in this space. And we really are just opening up the conversation, and that is the bit is how do we open the conversation, and how do we feel that we can raise this? And you know, even within the fact that I'm the norm to a certain extent, there's still power dynamics that, you know, in play in our institution, and, you know, how do we raise that? And sometimes in some really quite uncomfortable situations. So I hope that wasn't too much of a roadrunner. And thank you.
That was very interesting. Yes, so we don't have much time, so we go straight to the next presenter, Katie. Katie, are you there? Please unmute yourself. Is Katie in the room?
Sorry, I am here now. I didn't have the option to unmute myself, but I have got it now. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, my bad. Sorry, Kate.
That's all right. I'm glad it was fixable. I was like, oh no, I don't know how to do this. Okay. So, yes, thank you so much for... to everybody for all the things you've been saying. I'm going to talk briefly. I've got slides which have more detail on. That's for if you're interested in following any of this up. But I just wanted to make a few main points, really. So I've got a poll to start with, if we're able, Kerry, if you're able to drop that into the chat. I would like to know from you guys how much influence you feel you have on decolonising in your current situation. So there are choices in that poll. I'm not sure my work has or should have anything to do with decolonizing. I have no involvement. I can occasionally influence decolonizing decisions. I'm actively involved in decolonizing, or none of the above. So if I just give you a minute to do that, or not literally a minute. Kerry, I can't see any results on that. Oh, sorry, that's the joining page. That's why I can't see results. That's fine. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll turn the results on in a second, Kate, when people is so far 40 people just joining now.
Fab. Okay, thank you. I am on purpose being quiet because as a person with a disability, I struggle with multiple things. So I'm giving you a little bit of time just to do that. Ah, interesting. Okay, so there we go. That's showing that I can occasionally influence decolonizing decisions and actions is by far and away the one that's getting the most votes at the moment. And the others you can see for yourselves. So the one at the top, I'm not sure my work has or should have anything to do with decolonizing. There are a fair few people thinking that. The same with those who have no involvement, and then D, the fourth one down, that's actively involved in decolonizing. Okay, thank you very much for sharing that. Next slide, please. So I wanted to return to the point we started off with. So starting with why is my curriculum white? I come to decolonising from an educational developer perspective. I am interested very much in inclusive practice, and I think that the decolonising agenda, which quite rightly began focusing very much on race, is something that we need to expand. We need to look at the hidden power structures and who's affected by them, and maybe broaden this out. So there's a quote here, whiteness exceeds the individual and is a ubiquitous, multifaceted and inconsistent manifestation of power that informs social relations and the recognition of ability, potential and the value of certain types of knowledge. That thing about the ability, potential and the value of certain types of knowledge is at the heart of what's not right with education at the minute. Next slide, please. So really, this is all about power structures. So we've had, are still having a pandemic. We've had a pivot to online education, and these things have raised the issue of structural inequality. For the first time, some of these inequalities are now visible. They've always been there, but suddenly more of us can see them. That has affected, obviously, students in the way that you've heard from some of the other speakers. And also the thing that these are typically invisible to people that they don't affect. Next slide, please. So historically then, the norms in our education system are whiteness. That's very clear. They're also the people who put the education system together were privileged. So they were independently wealthy, presumed straight, able-bodied, European, male for the most part. So all of these things shaped how our education system was set up. And this is hidden, and this is what we talk about as the hidden curriculum. And I've got a lovely guide colleagues have just produced on that, which I'll drop into the chat later. Next slide, please. But I wanted to look at the effects that the hidden invisible, the hidden curriculum has on students. So this slide and the one after it, these are quotes, direct quotes from students for situations they've found themselves in. I haven't got time to read them all through, but I'm just going to highlight the issues that they're raising. So the first point is from a student of color who is being taught medicine and only being taught to diagnose symptoms in white-skinned individuals. The second is from a non-binary student who's come across an example of statistics where they're saying, this is an example of a binary statistic because all participants are male or female. That doesn't represent that student's experience. The third one's very concerning for all sorts of ethical reasons, but it's a professor of genetics who is discussing removing disease genes from the population in a way that suggests that removing disability is desirable. So in each of those instances, you have a student sitting in a classroom hearing these kind of views as part of the curriculum, unquestioning part of the curriculum, surrounded by other students and possibly other staff with no understanding of the impact. You know, these things are invisible unless they're your particular visibility. Next slide, please. The same is true of identity. So we have an issue with names. A student talking about the inability to pronounce the name which signifies her African origin, which meant that she stopped participating. She said, I found it easier. I didn't want to draw attention to myself. So the impact is huge. Another one there from a transgender student, university systems are only using the previous name, their dead name. So every single time that, you know, they participate in a Zoom call or whatever the university systems are organizing, it's their dead name, it's not them. Next slide, please. What I wanted to show with this is that these inequalities have always been here. We see them in attainment gaps. The whole, you know, calling it an attainment gap, this differentiation in degree attainment, puts it on the students. It's like saying you haven't achieved enough in our system. Well, that's not right. And here we have a nice quote from Advance HE, action needs to focus on institutional barriers and inequalities. So it's not the students who are failing to achieve, it's all of these hidden structures within their curriculum and within the education system in terms of who has access, who can participate, who is able to achieve and so on. So it's really important that you think about this from a designing for everybody perspective. And in our field, we're used to this idea.
A minute to go, please.
Okay, thank you, that's lovely. So next slide, please. And then the one after that, so we'll skip a slide, that's it. Lovely. So I wanted to talk about our role in decolonising, things that we can be doing. So we're from lots of different contexts, but if we seek EDI training opportunities, that will help. Will help us to see what isn't obviously visible. If we look for these hidden power structures, and we look for underrepresentation, and we try and make these things visible to others through our own actions, question, practice, and change it where we can. So things like tools, systems, activities, and so on. Acting inclusively, so promoting and modelling, things like digital accessibility is a big part of this as well. Universal design for learning, that kind of concept, scaffolding, decolonising activity, inclusive practice. Allyship, standing with those who need our support to normalise equality issues like inclusive language and pronouns. And working in partnership, which I think is huge. So this whole idea, nothing about us without us, comes from the disabled community. I think it's important for every community. Otherwise, it's simply those of us with good intent changing things for others, not working with others to smash these power structures and promote real equality. And lastly, push within your spheres of influence. So do all the good you can whenever you can. And I've got one more poll, which perhaps we'll run in the background, where I'm inviting you to list your spheres of influence. So any areas where you can influence practice, which might be conversations, it might be that you attend certain meetings, it might be that you're involved in sorting out what tools. We had a question in the chat about how to make sure tools that we're looking at purchasing are going to not have an impact on equality and so on. That's it. Yes, as I said, there's more detail in the slides, and there's a link to lots of really useful resources in the slides as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Katie. Thank you. That was interesting. Okay, so now we are running out of time. I think we can just go into the question and answer session. Yes, John? John, are you there? John C.
Oh, sorry. Okay, sorry, I've muted myself. Yeah, I think we'll let people sort of continue with this word cloud activity. We'll run over the hour, and obviously if people need to get away, that's absolutely fine. This will be recorded. But we'll do this, we'll take a couple of questions after this activity, and then we'll wrap up. So if you do have the time, please stick around and participate in this activity. Kerry, if you could share the screen of VVox again, we'll jump into that, and then we'll just take a couple of questions that have come up for Samantha and Kate to respond to.
Just a warning, the word cloud will move around. So if you're not keen on moving things on the screen, I just look away for a moment.
So once this is completed, can we fix it? Can we lock it in place, Kerry, so it's not changing?
Yeah.
Yeah, great. Okay, should we do that now, Kerry? So Kate, did you want to just maybe comment on this word cloud? It's now paused.
Yeah. No, thank you so much for putting that in. That's really interesting. So you can see that we've got all kinds of different concepts and spheres of influence, all kinds of different areas where we can try and ask questions and push development, particularly here. Digital technology, meetings, conversations, policy, design work, guidelines, practice, recruitment, that's very important, assessment, learning, accessibility, criticality, working groups. Fantastic. Yeah, thank you. So if we all do as much as we can, wherever we can, hopefully we make a little difference in the way things move forward.
Indeed. I think we need to write that down, Kate. That's a great quote. Okay, so just a couple of questions that have come up, and maybe Samantha and Kate in particular, you could respond to these. So there's one from Rakita saying, how can we promote democratizing learning with technology and raise awareness of critical tell, technology enhanced learning? Samantha, would you like to take that, and then Kate?
Oh, that's an interesting one. I think it comes down to right at the beginning when people conceptualize their courses. So I did a bit of thinking out loud last week about kind of what I thought education could and should be. And part of me was this about people finding themselves and their voice. And we've got to create a culture and a structure that allows that for students. For me, I've got a fundamental issue with our education system in that everything is about competition between institutions and between students. And that becomes very difficult. And when you've set up that false competition in many ways between things, it doesn't leave the space or the freedom to do those things, to take that risk, to open that up. And it's a hard task. I think on an individual level, we can think about our lessons. We can think about the scheme of work for our module. We can think about our program. But we are fighting something that is systemic all the way through. And it's not even just in higher ed. Literally, it starts in primary school, that a child is assessed in nursery with a prediction for how they're going to perform in primary and secondary school. And they get, and it's all leads and streamed and blah. And I guess I have no easy answer of the, apart from, we do what we can in the space that we can, but we question and we feedback. And when there are consultations on things, we make our voices heard. And I think that's the, we don't sit back. Where we have a voice, we use it.
Wonderful, thank you. Kate, would you like to comment on that? Would you like me to repeat the question?
Yes, please, sorry.
Okay, so how can we promote democratizing learning with technology and raise awareness of critical tell?
I think it feeds into stuff we do already in terms of staff development around tell. So criticality, we are already, there's a lot of work being done thinking about criticality in terms of our students. So I think a lot of that is transferable into looking at tech. I've forgotten the first half of the question again, I'm sorry.
It was about how do we promote democratizing learning with technology.
Right, there, that's something I think some of this comes down to, we can tag some of it to the digital accessibility agenda, because that's gaining a lot of traction at the minute, as it should. But there are cultural implications for use of tech, obviously, as well. So it's not just to do with disability. So I think where you are writing guidance, if you are in a situation where you can give guidance or somewhere you can raise questions, that's, because we're all from such different contexts, I can't give more specific advice than that. I'm sorry. I hope that's not too unhelpful.
That's fine. That's great. Oh, wonderful. Thank you. We've got this from Kerry, I think. That's great.
Sorry, I was just trying to share the files with the, but it actually shares it to the screen. Okay. Forgive me.
That's okay. A really good question from Theodora as well. And I'll ask it to both of you, if you want to take it, and then maybe we can ask some of the other speakers to respond as well. So how do we keep the balance between opening the table to marginalised groups and not dumping on them all the emotional labour for training the rest of the world to respect us? Kate, would you like to take that first, and then Samantha, and then we'll open it out to the other speakers.
I think this is such a key question, and thank you very much for asking it. So what I would really like to see, and it's a pipe dream wish, but I would really like to see it, is for the proper acknowledgement to be given to people in marginalised group who are engaged in this kind of work. So time in your working contract, or if you're a student, paid time as a possible opportunity, while also bearing in mind that it may be time is very scarce for people in marginalized situations because of their personal characteristics. So the emotional point is very important. I think it's really important that we keep saying there shouldn't be any expectation. I have a disability. I don't necessarily want to be the stand-up person for disability in the room. Quite often I am, just because. But yeah, I think it is about giving appropriate partnership opportunities and making it clear that this is an equal thing. This isn't here's a little seat as a token at the table You know, we really need to change things. So let's make it more meaningful.
Thank you. And that comment about opening the table, I think Taskina's comment illustrates who owns the table. It's a really good comment there as well.
It reminds me of Shirley Chisholm's thing about, you know, if they don't give you a chair, bring your own. And she was talking about kind of race and gender politics in 70s US, which, you know, they still do not have a nationwide gender equality law, which is just insane. But there we go. I can't say anything other than what Kate said. I think for someone who, I'm not a marginalized group, so for me it's listening and working in partnership with people and having their voice. It may be that, you know, I can take some of that labor and I want to, but not speaking for them. You know, and not, again, it's that being that savior, which is not what we want. It's not that I am not going to speak for you. I'm not going to pretend that I know, but I want to talk to you and I want to understand and I want to help give your voice. And I think there was that whole thing, it may have been a CEDA event about decolonizing, where, you know, as a student commented that there was nothing African about African studies in SOAS, that all the resources in Africa were written by white Europeans, which is just kind of, you know, a lot.
Okay.
I'm just going to
thank you. Maybe I can ask Taskeen and then Sonia and Mona and John to just have a quick final comment about this particular question, and then we'll close the session.
Yes, while we were talking here and I am listening to you, I remembered a very interesting comment. Once a European North American group was providing professional development for teachers in one of the developing countries, and then one of the teachers stood out and said, "Why is it that always we are thrown with on top of our heads with curriculum and with guidances and tools and resources? Why isn't it that you listen to us? We need to be heard." And this was very powerful. We need to be heard. There is nothing in what you are offering that relates to us. And he just left the room and he was so furious. And I realized there is something wrong with how the programs are designed, always top down, which is actually, which needs to change. Yes.
Thank you very much, Mona. Taskeen?
Thanks. I think I'll just conclude with saying that we really need to work with Global South researchers and also just people on the ground. So part of that is Global North Institutes means sharing resources with them to help them mobilize. And it's not just giving voice, but actually having them be heard and owning the conversation. Often the narrative is shaped and then we ask as researchers, we would ask them to input on a certain point. But I think really the conversation needs to be led from those researchers, those people that have been that have a lived experience of these situations. So I think we need to look at the power dynamics there. Like more and more you see that the literature that's coming out from decolonization is actually from Global North Institutes or wider European academics. And so we really need to think about who is leading the narrative on this topic. And like I think one of the comments said, like, does decolonization need to be decolonized?
Thank you. Sonia, are you still here? Would you like to speak? I'm not sure if she's left. John, are you still around?
Yeah, for sure. Yes. I mean, I'm just incredibly grateful to be exposed to all of this. Conscious of my own kind of inadequacies in, I don't know, reading and thinking it through, but very grateful for the provocation to think it through further. And I'm quite conscious that I mean, people have made remarks about social justice on the one hand and anti-racism on the other, and I can see this topic just being a kind of reflection in some, or an aspect in many respects of just the power structures within our society, and kind of intimidated by the enormity of it all. And I think the shape of my head is probably such that I'm better at thinking, what can I do now? What can I do here? But very grateful for other people making the connections and kind of taking me through to tomorrow. I guess I'm not a learning technologist in the sense it's normally portrayed. And so I don't have much to contribute in that respect. But I think actually that, again, that's only one corner and one contribution. And it's very good to see the amount of interaction between the Association of Learning Technology, which is essentially a UK-based professional organisation, and so many, many, many people from so many different time zones, actually, some of whom are kind of staying up late and some of whom are getting up early, and many of whom are missing lunch, I imagine. All I can say is, I want to do this more and I want to do this better. And keep in touch with everyone. And it's going to take me quite some time to kind of assimilate all of the chat and all of the remarks and all of the input. And I will definitely be doing that. And hope that, thank you for your forbearance, actually. I mean, this felt rather like, I don't know, some mixture of being the sorcerer's apprentice, trying to keep hold of the tiger's tail, catching up with the interest and the demand and the offers, and hopefully we can do kind of slightly better in that respect in January and in February. So thank you ever so much, everyone.
Thank you, John. And Agnes, would you like to add any comments as well to this?
Now, I think I've learned a lot, even though it was so short. I've learned a lot from the presenters. Of course, this topic of decolonizing learning technology, we need to, to keep on talking about this, because I feel if we are not careful, this technology, especially this learning technology, can perpetuate what we are trying to, trying to decolonize the curriculum. And if we are not careful, the way we are using the technology for teaching and learning, we are going to perpetuate what we are trying to decolonize. So yeah, I think we need to keep on having these conversations.
We certainly do. And, and on that note, myself and John and Agnes have been talking about these, and there are other opportunities. And I think, I'm getting the sense that actually I'm going to be handing over the baton to other people to be leading some of these other sessions with Agnes, with John, and with whoever else wants to step forward and offer a chance to host and offer the chance to present as well in these other sessions that we're looking to run. Tweet chat, hopefully in the next few weeks, but also a couple of follow-up webinars. So another one to sort of have sessions like these, to talk, outlining some of the key issues. But then what we'd like to do is have a third webinar that looks at trying to sort of bring some of these ideas together, and start to sort of arrange some ideas and have some actions from them, rather than just talking about it. How can we collaborate together? What can we take forward? As individuals, as groups, as ALT and other organisations. So, hopefully this is just the start of a longer conversation. John, would you like to comment on that? And I've just seen Mike has said about the strike action. Good point there. We'll keep that in mind as well. John, would you like to make any final closing comments?
No, like I say, I'm just incredibly grateful to be to have the opportunity to be part of this and to be exposed to everyone's ideas and reactions and thoughts, and for the chance to build on it as well.
Thanks. I wanted to say one final thing, which was which I haven't forgotten about, which was mentioned in the chat, I believe, earlier about the ALT Winter Conference, which is happening soon. And there is a particular sort of discussion around this ethical framework for learning technology, which I'm sure will embrace a lot of the things we've talked about today. So if you haven't already registered, please do. And of course, there'll be lots of other presentations as well on many similar topics and lots of other ones as well. It's a wonderful event. So please look out for that, as well as these other events that we've just mentioned today. So just to absolutely conclude now, thank you very much, everybody, for joining today. Thank you for all of our speakers. Thank you, Agnes, for chairing the session so well. And we're really grateful for all of the interest that we've had. Like I've mentioned, there are other webinars ahead. So if you do have an interest in speaking, in hosting, in doing anything, please let myself or John or Agnes know, and we'd love to include you in future sessions. Okay, well, thank you very much indeed, everyone, and have a good day.